Well, today, Minister Hyatt and I are announcing that the government will be setting up a new productivity commission early next year. The commission will have a wide-ranging brief to help increase New Zealand's productivity across the public sector and the private sector. The commission is part of the National Act Confidence and Supply Agreement signed after the last election, and we'll be looking to pass legislation setting up the commission by the end of this year so that it is up and running from April next year. This is just one more step in the government's program to lift New Zealand's economic growth. We've had a lopsided and underperforming economy in the last 5 or 6 years. The government has set out a comprehensive program, but at the core of that is increasing productivity. So the government has looked to the Australian model of a productivity commission as an independent and arm's length body, which over time in Australia has built up a reputation across the political spectrum. So we would expect that the commission will help us address in a considered and consistent fashion the issue of productivity that's at the core of lifting our economic performance. Minister Hyde.
Thanks, Bill. This is a very proud day for us, for the ACT Party. We have long been a fan of the Australian Productivity Commission. We see it clear that if we're going to lift our standard of living, we need to increase the New Zealand economy's productivity. What's impressed us about the Australian Productivity Commission is the ability of politicians to shift complex and tough policy issues across to an independent body of commissioners who can then engage with the public and do the analysis, sort of somewhat free of the day-to-day politics of the issue, and then for the politicians finally to receive that work and make a decision on it. And in the process, it's clear that the Australian Productivity Commission has often improved public understanding of the issues and acceptance of the policies that are needed to increase Australia's performance. What we did in our confidence and supply agreement was agree that we would look together as two parties in government at having a productivity commission for New Zealand. I think that's important. We didn't want to twist the arm of the National Party's up its back. What we wanted to do was say, let's actually have a look at it together and see if it would make a difference to New Zealand. The great thing about working with Prime Minister Key and Bill English and the other ministers is that they've been very genuine and looking at the issues that ACT has put on the table and have concluded that a productivity commission would be good for New Zealand. And so here we are today with Cabinet having agreed. It's also important to note that we're conscious of not increasing government spending or adding to the bureaucracy, and so we recognise that the Productivity Commission would be doing some work that would previously been done by departments, and so the money to fund the Productivity Commission is coming out of existing government departments' budgets. So it's no new money. What it is, though, is a new and independent body to look at public policy issues referred to it by the Minister of Finance, but to look at it in a way that's independent of the ministers. I'm happy to take your questions.
How will it decide what's reviewed? Do you envisage it'll be the government saying we want you to look into this, or can they sort of start their own reviews?
No, it's very much their work program is decided by the Minister of Finance. And when we studied the Australian Productivity Commission and talked to Gary Banks, that was a key part of their success. So it was, if you like, the government of the day would set their research agenda, so it would be useful to the government of the day, but then the commission actually goes away and does it, independent of the politicians and the minister.
So what's on your agenda? I presume you've got a shortlist now.
No, we've got to the stage where we've agreed to have one, and we're working to establish the legislation and then get it up and running next year, and then we'll take a look at it then.
You've got
it looks like a much smaller thing than the Aussie one. It's got a staff of 190 over there. You're talking about 20 or 21 here. Mm. And also a narrower brief, much more anchored in productivity than the range of, what is it, a range of economic, social and environmental issues, including the welfare of Australians. Yes. That sounds like a broader mandate there than envisaging here.
Yes, and we took advice from Gary Banks on the one that they set up in Victoria. And so the idea is to, you know, get it started and not start with a, you know, big bureaucracy. His recommendation for us was to start small and get it established and get it working and then make decisions subsequent to that.
You've got it down envisaging it doing 2 inquiries in the first year and then 3 inquiries a year after that, but you've got no idea what those might be. That sort of suggests that you might have some sort of agenda in mind for it.
No. And there is an agenda in mind for it, and that is to actually be looking at matters of public policy to see how we can improve our economic performance. But I myself don't have, you know, here would be the ideal 2 inquiries to be doing. My idea has always been, and the ACT Party's idea have always been, to get a commission that would be available on an ongoing basis to governments of whatever colour or stripe, to actually have that independent public policy advice.
How are you going to extract money out of the public service, Mr. English? It's already strapped for cash at the moment.
We have.
Well, what, for this?
Yes.
From where?
From across 29 departments.
What won't they be doing now that they were doing previously, those 29 government departments?
Well, there was 29 departments which... sorry, excuse me, I'm just giving you a drink of water. You may recall the previous government had a productivity agenda, and we found 29 departments who were participating in some kind of work related to productivity, and so they've all contributed, large ones and more policy, more economic ones have contributed more, and quite a number have contributed a small amount.
So I guess that's when will you decide who's not?
Maybe be Treasury and Economic Development?
Yeah, Treasury's been one of the larger contributors, as has MED.
When will you decide who's on the Commission itself? Well, what sort of qualities will you be looking for?
Well, that'll be over the next few months. It's important that this is an entity that is seen to be independent, as well as being legislatively independent, and which can earn respect across the political spectrum by the quality of its work, as the Australian one has done. So we'll be looking to a pretty broad base of experience on there from the private sector, academia, certainly public sector experience, and people with some standing and certainly with expert analytical skills, because the kind of issues they'll be dealing with are likely to be fairly challenging regulatory type issues.
Do you envisage there being any employer and or union representative? On
that? Look, we wouldn't see it as a representative model, but this has got to be about breadth of experience of the economy and the expertise to deal with complex issues. Sorry?
You're only talking about 4 commissions?
At the moment we are. That's right.
Why does this require legislation, and have you had any discussions with other parties other than ACT, obviously, about getting it through? Not that it won't get through.
Yeah, no, well, we're pretty confident about having the numbers for it.
Yeah. Yeah, but I mean, have you tried to get any other parties on board? Because you say you want it to be as independent as possible and as non-political as possible. So.
Yeah, we'd be looking for support from the other parties in Parliament.
Why does it need legislation, though? Why can't you just set it up and...
Maybe if I could answer that. The experience has been it's independence that has... created the public acceptance of the Productivity Commission, and that independence has come through, you know, the fact that it's set up in statute and by the behaviour of the Commission itself. And as you can imagine, we've had some experience since coming into government of putting in task forces where we can drag in expertise and an outside look, and that's been fabulous. But of course, they're a temporary measure, and of course they're looking, you know, they're at the whim of the politicians and the ministers. But once you set this thing up in statute, then it is truly independent. It has its funding source and it can be seen to be independent. And so that's the significance of that. And that's important because it's the difference between having a department that's doing work on an issue to a minister compared to actually having an independent commission who's doing work and is protected from the minister. And why that matters is very often a government, the issues come up, there's the Australian experience I'm reporting here, an issue comes up and a minister starts talking about it, immediately it's embroiled in the politics of, you know, the minister, the opposition, what's his or her agenda, so on and so forth. But what the Productivity Commission enables you to do is to raise, look, here's an issue for our country, put it across to the Productivity Commission. It's statutorily independent from the minister and from politics. It can go and do the work because of its reputation, experience. It's seen to be independent. It produces the work, it consults with the public, gets the feedback, and then makes recommendations, and it comes back into the political arena at that point. And so it creates a process by which complex issues can be looked at independent of the ministers, and you can only do that really if it's got statutory backing.
Stats today released figures showing that productivity was heading in the wrong direction, 1.5% in the March year. Your leader, Roger Douglas, well, not your leader, I'm awfully sorry.
I thought you might have come from another press conference.
Your colleague, he said unless the government sacrifices some of its populist tactics and starts implementing the policies needed to improve our economy, we'll slip further behind Australia. Now, do you agree with him?
Oh, I think New Zealand, and I don't think there's any disagreement, that New Zealand needs to lift its performance, and to lift its performance, it needs to lift its policies. And I guess where we differ with National is National's got a path of moving there gradually, acts a bit more impatient, and you'd expect that with two different parties.
Do you expect this the Commission to help out with some of the public sector reform that's been signalled by the government to date?
I wouldn't have thought so, unless it was given a specific task to look at a particular issue. But, you know, particular issues of, you know, organisation or public sector wouldn't necessarily be in its brief. There will be public sector issues that it could consider, and certainly it would be up to the government to say, look, you know, have a look at this. But that wouldn't be something that I'd be particularly thinking. The organisation of central government may not be something that we'd consider.
And would yesterday the numbers, you know, the numbers that came out showed that they were bringing public service jobs down. Today this is a new bureaucracy. How do you reconcile those two things?
Easily, because while it's a new agency, it's actually taking over existing funding. So, if you like, it's a rearrangement and an establishment of an independent body. So there's no new funding, no net funding, and no, therefore, net increase in terms of numbers. And of course, the whole point of having an agency such as this is actually so you can do a better job.
Will its process be like the Aussie one of writing draft reports and having public consultation and hearings and that whole?
We would expect so, and we expect and hope that it will work quite closely and learn from the Australian experience. But it's a bit early to say this will be its precise operating model, because we need to go down the track of establishing the legislation, appointing the commissioners, and then ultimately it'll be up to the commissioners. But I would expect them to be following quite closely what has clearly been a success in Australia.
Is there a danger, though, that you can, that this can be a lengthy process and it can be politically expedient to kick an issue to touch by saying, well, we'll give this task to the Productivity Commission, we won't have to worry about it for 18 months?
Well, we've seen that before. We saw it with, you know, for example, a Royal Commission on Auckland. But at the end of the day, the report comes back and a government has to deal with it.
Mr. English, one might have an agenda for the Commission. Where do you think there are problems to look at? Where does New Zealand have any productivity problems?
We have a wide-ranging review of regulation going on right now, ranging from the Food Act through the Local Government Act, Building Act, Resource Management Act, and a number of less significant ones as well. One of the requirements in our view of improving your economic performance is to have a consistent process of policy review. New Zealand has a habit of doing it in bursts and then taking a rest for a while. So part of the job of the Productivity Commission will be to, for instance, continue with rolling reviews of our regulatory structures. Now the government's got started on that. There'll be no doubt be areas which we believe will benefit from significant expertise and independence. but the intention is that it's ongoing rather than episodic.
How does this fit with the regulation bill that you're hoping to get through in the near future? Because I see it can hold inquiries into regulations, but how is there not going to be a double up there?
No, it's not a double up, because the regulatory responsibility bill sets up a process for government passing new legislation and looking at existing legislation. And so that's across all legislation. The Productivity Commission is looking at particular sectors, particular industries, particular issues that from time to time will come up and which a government wants an independent, you know, policy view on. So they're not the same thing, if you follow me. Like, the Regulatory Responsibility Bill just sets up a better process for a government considering new legislation, and indeed provides for a systematic review by departments of existing legislation.
Have you got a commitment from National to back that bill?
No, not yet, but...
Are you confident that you will get?
Very confident.
What about you, Mr. English? Are you happy with it?
Well, we've got... there's been the task force that was part of the confidence and supply agreement. We're keen to see some kind of institutionalised arrangements where all government regulation is scrutinised in a transparent way. So we'll... You know, we've been discussing it for a couple of months.
Do you have any issues with the draft bill that came back from the task force, and particularly the breadth of some of the principles?
Well, we're spending a bit of time getting a good understanding of what was intended and what the implications might be. So you've got two or three different sources of proposals for this, including the work the Select Committee was doing under the last government. So this has been it's been a bit of a rolling argument for two or three years, and we would like to make some, you know, get some progress on one piece of legislation.
Fair to say that you'd be hoping that this kind of body might do get some more politically acceptable solutions than the 2025 task force managed?
Oh, I was actually pleased with the work of the 2025 task force.
But other people weren't.
Well. We always knew that it was going to be a big challenge to lift New Zealand's performance to the level it needed to catch Australia by 2025. And what the 2025 task force did was actually lay down the challenge. And you knew what was involved. Ultimately, it shows you, and this is the point, that the decision is to be made by, you know, elected politicians. But what you have is, here was a blueprint that could do it, and the elected politician said, no, that's a bit rich, you know, we're not going to do that. But I'm looking forward to the 2025 task force report this year.
So just to be clear, the funding for this, you said, would come out of the 29 departments that have already got money to do this kind of work, and there's no new money. But is the actual amount that each of those departments was allocated, has that all come out, or have they been left some of it to do, and the other question is, the 21 staff, will they come out of those departments, or will they be new employees?
The with respect to the money, if it's you know, now that they could see that having productivity work meant that some money might have to be transferred, of course they are a bit less keen to tell you that it's productivity work. So I couldn't.
They had a lot of it beforehand.
They had a lot of it before, but not quite so much now. So I couldn't tell you whether there's some left. I mean, clearly those departments have all kept policy capacity. So there's a defined contribution, and they've all made those contributions. With respect to the staff, it looks like a significant proportion of the staff could end up being seconded from existing departments.
Minister, just I know it's in your report in this release, but could you just tell us what the budget is and how many staff you foresee being in, just for the camera?
Well, it'll be a budget of somewhere between 4 or 5 million and up to 20 staff.
Just going back to potential agendas, regulation reviews doesn't really sort of set the world on fire in public imagination. Have you got any other ideas?
I'm sorry, what was that one?
Well, regulation review, I mean, every government seems to harp on about regulation review and red tape hunts and things. Have you got any other ideas that the Productivity Commission could be looking at apart from regulations?
Oh, well, it's very simple. You can look at, you know, the sort of work that the Australian Productivity Commission has done, and you know, that's a practical example where they've looked at impacts, for example, of an ageing population on Australia. They've looked at immigration. They've looked at rural water use and the environment. They are the sorts of issues that the Australian Productivity Commission has looked at. I'm reluctant to sort of grab one or two things, because then that'll suggest that, you know, there's a prejudged agenda. But certainly the Australian Productivity Commission has covered a wide field and established an enviable track record of performance.
How will our commission work with these? Do you envisage that there will start to be Australasian wide reviews of certain issues? Or?
Quite potentially. And you can also imagine a bit of cross-fertilisation with staff, and obviously staff here seeking guidance, just like ministers have, from the Australian Productivity Commission on particular issues and how they've gone about it, because you wouldn't necessarily wish to reinvent the wheel. But quite possibly you can imagine there being areas of concern across both countries. And I know the Prime Minister discussed with the Australian Prime Minister when he was over there the concept of a productivity commission, and indeed thank the Prime Minister for the efforts made in helping us.
Well, a question on tax, sorry. The Retirement Policy and Research Centre put out work today, which they say the tax working group vastly overestimated how much money was invested in rental properties, that it's half, at least half the $200 billion. And I just wondered whether you'd been getting any work back from Treasury on that, and what implications that might have if the figure is right in terms of the work you're looking at.
Look, it doesn't make any significant difference to the tax policy issues. Whether it's a bit bigger or a bit smaller than the numbers that were used by the tax working group, the effective tax rate on some forms of property investment's been pretty low, and we are looking at increasing that effective tax rate. So the decisions aren't conditional on how much is invested in it. Most measures of property investment in New Zealand show that compared to other countries, we have a bigger proportion of our wealth tied up in property than other countries do.
So could that alter